There was a festival of flattery on the White House lawn today to celebrate the passage of the Republican tax cut bill.
Something this big, something this generational, something this profound could not have been done without exquisite presidential leadership. Mr. President, thank you for getting us over the finish line.
Thank you, President Trump, for allowing us to have you as our president and to make America great again.
You're one heck of a leader, and we're all benefiting from it. This bill could not have passed without you.
President Donald Trump delivered a great victory for the American people.
Is that SNL? Is that real? Complimenting President Trump has become something of a ritual at the White House, but have other presidents expected such praise? Let's discuss now. CNN presidential historians Timothy Naftali and Douglas Brinkley here. I mean, listen, you... I mean, what is going on here? By the way, you gentlemen look so handsome. You're such fantastic historians. I am just honored to be on television with you. Douglas, you first. We saw an enormous celebration on the White House steps today, but you say high fives are better done when they're out of the office, right?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh, look at
first
them.
Off, first off, we've got a president with a 35% approval rating. This is a president who hasn't been able to put up any points on the board this year. And now, lo and behold, suddenly at the end of the year, they got this through. But it's worth high-fiving. It is a historic victory. But I think the exaggeration of having to kiss the ring of Donald Trump, it almost seems like a scene out of The Godfather we just saw, not what you expect from a president of a democracy.
What's happening here?
I haven't heard this kind of sycophancy since I listened to the Nixon tapes where Henry Kissinger is telling the president what a remarkable human being he is.
Yeah. But well, I mean, the president hasn't always had the best relationships with all of these people that you see there who are praising him. Do you think this is a turning point between the president and Congress?
Well, that you'd have to then believe that this is real and that they believe that they
the
really mean this.
Did the wedding happen already and I missed it?
But No. I think who knows? But I think one of the lessons that Congress learned was that this president is insecure, and that if you want to work with this president, you have to make him feel great about himself. And they didn't do it in the health care debate, and they decided to do it over tax cuts. And by the way, they did get a concession from Donald Trump because he insisted on bringing the corporate tax rate to 15% and didn't get it, and he's still applauding.
Yeah. Well, this isn't about, listen, it's a victory for them.
Oh,
it's a victory
time for
the president, but this sort of, as you say, sycophancy, it's really just bizarre to watch. But the bigger question here, the broader question, the more important question, has there ever been a president who has passed a piece of major legislation that would actually hurt the people in his home state as much as New York officials are saying, Timothy?
No. Well, you know, the last time, 31 years ago, the last time we had such a comprehensive change in our tax system, it was a bipartisan measure. It was passed by a Democratic House, and although the Republicans controlled the Senate, 33 Democratic senators voted for the 1986 Tax Reform Act. So it involved trade-offs, regional, ideological, and party trade-offs. This one didn't have any, and Donald Trump didn't care that his hometown is one of the hardest hit places in the United States by this tax reform.
Yeah. Do you have something to add, Douglas?
Well, just that Donald Trump now is giving Republicans something to run on in 2018. They had nothing before this. Now it's going to be we're the party of tax cuts. They don't have to be Trumpian now. They just have to be pro-tax cuts. And so it might be seen as a unifying agent for the alt-right wing of the party or the establishment wings, and at least it gives them, for the time being, a bit of an offense. And you see them also taking the offense on the Mueller report. You're watching what Fox News is doing and the echo chamber going on here, that there's a feeling now that they might be able to survive Trump. Many Republicans were worried they were headed down the tube if they couldn't produce one single major signature piece of legislation in 2017.
Yeah. Listen, this president often rattles off what he believes are his accomplishments in his first year in office. So let's take a look at the facts. Trump says he helped to defeat ISIS. First, ISIS was on the decline when President Obama left office. Also, the idea that ISIS has been defeated is incorrect. ISIS-inspired groups have found strongholds around the world. The president says he brought unemployment to a 16-year low. The unemployment rate has been dropping since its peak in 2009. It's true it's at a 16-year low, but it is too early to credit President Trump's policies. President Trump says he has created 1.7 million jobs since being elected. That number is accurate, but if you look at President Obama, he created 2.9 million jobs in the final jobs report before he left office. Why does he feel the need to list these accomplishments? And also, the one he also credits the stock market, which is incorrect as well, saying that he had the biggest stock market. Obama at this time had a better performing stock market. The best performing stock market was under Bill Clinton, by the way. It's not Donald Trump. So why does he continue to do this?
Well, I believe, and you have to ask him, but if you look objectively at the American people's response to Donald Trump, most Americans reject him. Mm-hmm. His public approval ratings are lower than any modern president in his first term. So he's not getting love and affection from the American people, and that's what he needs and wants. Mm-hmm. One of the challenges for Trump was to build a unifying message. He didn't run on one. He ran on a sectarian message. Since the inauguration, he has not done anything to try to widen his base. And that's why he's doubling down, and he wants people to see that even doubling down, he's a success. It's a shame.
Yeah. Douglas, as far as approval ratings are concerned, President Trump isn't even in the same league as his predecessors. Here's what our CNN poll shows. His historically low approval rating is at 35%. It's lower than all of the previous president's approval ratings taken the same month of their first year in office. Is passing tax reform enough to help President Trump and Republicans in 2018, you think? You said it gives them something to run on, but is that enough?
No, it isn't. George W. Bush had a 86% approval rating at this time after his first year. John F. Kennedy, 77%. George Herbert Walker Bush, 71%. And to 35? I mean, he's in the basement right now. There's nothing quite like it. So, of course, he's trying to say we're tired of winning or repeating his campaign lines. What most people are going to remember from 2016, it's been the year of the women, the march on Washington that started early in his administration. It ended with Time magazine picking women activists fighting against sexual harassment. We have a president being charged galore with sexual harassment. We had the FBI closing in on a White House. He's been a president under the microscope, under investigation, almost with an asterisk mm-hmm. next to his name for the entire year. And getting a tax cut bill at the end of the year ain't going to cut it. Kids aren't going to be lining up at the Trump Library 20 years from now to see the tax cut pen under glass. They're looking for great, big, bold presidential initiatives. Kennedy's first year of the moonshot and Eisenhower going interstate highway system.
Yeah. Listen, if you want the truth about the stock market, because everyone is raving about that, I would suggest that everyone go to fortune.com and read how Justin Wolfer responded to the president's claim. And it's fascinating. It's facts, just the facts. Thank you all. I appreciate it. When we come back, the top Democrat on the Senate Intelligence Committee sending the White House a stern warning about firing special counsel Robert Mueller. What Mark Warner is calling red lines and what he is urging lawmakers to do if President Trump crosses them. That's next.